I'm guessing you guys actually have Mac clients then, if you're still here. Right. So just to, before I get started, the answer to a couple of the questions or some addendums to what Jay was saying about some of his stuff, X11 is available on the installer CD for any OS X installer, so that's pretty easy to grab. Apache, another really good reason to do what Jay was talking about, rip out the old Apache files and insert new ones, is because Apache as it's built on OS X is not that great. So if you rebuild it from scratch, it actually operates maybe 250% better performance. I mean, it does not perform on OS X very well. So there's a program called MAMP that'll do a lot of that for you. But just to be, you know, continue with what he was saying, there's another great reason other than security to replace the Apache configuration on OS X, which is performance. So, the repair permission stuff, if someone builds a Cocoa installer and puts a DMG file in there that indicates the permissions that should be applied and timestamps them appropriately, in other words, if they build a proper installer for it, then when you do a repair permissions, it should respect those permissions. So, and then I was just going to give a heads up to Little Snitch as well. That's a good program. And Little Snitch and PGP both I don't include in my presentation, but they definitely deserve inclusion. So, all right. So Mac OS X security tools. Basically, I'm just picking up where Jay left off. So rather than, rather than more of an internal side, I'm talking about, you know, different system tools that you apply after you do Bastille, so to speak. But I definitely heavily endorse Bastille. I've been using it in beta as well, and it's great. So, and obviously, we definitely always assume that the system is going to be compromised when we deploy them, right? I mean, not assume that it is, but assume that it can be. Does anyone mind if I kill my presentation and give it the way I gave my last one? I hate the transforms and things. So, all right, so as Jay talked about, Bastille is a great tool for locking down Macs. A lot of what it does involves the internals, ipfw, some of the other services like cups, obviously, we saw. And we're going to pick up where he left off. The first tool, Nagios. Who here runs Nagios? There's a great book on Nagios available, I think, at the No Starch desk from No Starch Press. It's a great book. Nagios is more of a system monitoring tool, and you can build customizable rules for it. In large-scale Mac deployments, it's great. It builds perfectly on the Mac. In fact, at Macworld last year, someone gave a talk specifically on running Nagios on Mac networks. So, big fan of Nagios. Who here's used Radmind? Radmind-D. The Apple certified trainer. this is a program out of the university level, which have very large scale Mac deployments in a lot of cases. I think University of Helsinki is over 20,000. And it's a centralized software update tool for non-packaged installers. If you have more than, I'd say, 5,000 Macs, then you've pretty much outgrown what ARD can do for you, and jumping into Radmind is definitely a good solution. You can also deploy config files and other specific file-based things. And it's free. And then Tripwire. Who here has used Tripwire? Not everybody? You're here. Have you, anyone who's used Tripwire, have you opened your laptop at the conference? Yay, you admitted it. So Tripwire makes hashes of your file system, and then you can quickly compare for system changes and things of that nature. There is a great GUI tool for Tripwire, if you're still using it at the command line for the Mac, called Checkmate. It plugs directly into your system preferences. It does not work on the Intel chipset, which I've been testing a lot of stuff on the Intel chipset, but the tools that I use mostly. You know, for that, you might still need to use the command line tripwire, but it's a pretty good GUI tool, and it plugs straight into your system preferences. So RK Hunter is just a thing that looks for known rootkits. Personally, I script both Checkmate and RK Hunter, or Tripwire and RK Hunter, to run at night on systems to check. OS X server specifically comes with ClamAV installed, so you can actually, without doing any installation or any updates, you can actually script ClamAV to run every night. So it's built into the OS. For OS X workstation, it's not. There is a program that will build it into the OS at the GUI level called ClamXAV. Who's run that before? That's a great little tool. My only issue with ClamXAV is it does not actually repair viruses. It only detects them. So you still need to end up getting Norton antivirus if you get infected, which most Macs are infected. And that's not necessarily Apple's fault. It's Microsoft Office in most cases. So next, Snort. Who's run HenWen before? And who's run Snort at the command line on OS X before? So a couple fewer hands. FreeBSD doesn't count. As Apple engineers often tell me, OS X is not FreeBSD. When I talk about editing certain files, they're like, dude, that's not going to work. So anyways, HenWen is helping Mac people be more secure by actually applying not only intrusion detection, but intrusion prevention based on the Guardian Perl script that you can launch within.
So of the people who use HenWen, who uses the Guardian script inside of HenWen? So I have teachers that do that, which is kind of an interesting concept. Like your third grade teacher running an intrusion prevention system on her Mac. But that's a great tool, especially if you're not concerned about a client node actually getting being used for DNS, DOSs, and things of that nature. So as far as Guardian goes, there is always the ability to, you know, essentially attack the system. I mean, who all saw Dan's talk last year? Right. So you can always attack a system that you know is running some kind of intrusion detection system using known IP addresses that machine needs to communicate with, and therefore DOS the machine based on the network services that it needs, right? So that's something to be concerned with if you're running Snort or HenWen on servers. But for the most part, if you're doing extrusion detection type of security, you don't really need to worry about that, for the most part. And then Snort, obviously, awesome custom rule sets. You can, in a lot of Mac environments, we see SonicWalls. That seems to be a very good marriage, SonicWall and Apple OS X. And in those cases, you can actually run different plugins for Snort that will update the SonicWall and block IPs based on, you know, rules that have been tripped up. So, also, by the way, HenWen takes out the need to install libcap. It actually automatically does all the things that you would normally have to do by hand to get Snort to work on that. So it's a nice little GUI tool. It also doesn't run on Intel chips. So App or Mode Desktop, ARD 3.0 has a lot of updates over ARD 2. If you were using ARD 2, it's worth the extra $500 or whatever for it. It's used primarily for keeping software updated, deploying package-based installers. It basically, Radmind should have gone after this in my presentation because it fills the gaps of ARD. So ARD gives Apple OS X B and C. It gives it the ability to send shell commands to client machines without SSH. But what it doesn't do is it doesn't deploy non-package-based installers. So in a lot of environments, people will build lists of the files that have been changed and then deploy those in ARD, but Radmind actually kind of fills that void. So local administrative users automatically have access to an ARD client. So if you turn ARD on, any local admin user has access to the system.
And then, I already said that. So the next thing, Open Directory, I said password policies, but I should have just said Open Directory policies. A big movement in the Mac OS X server community is to cross-realm Mac server with Active Directory, therefore providing Open Directory, which is Apple's version of Active Directory, and Active Directory to your network. What that enables you to do is have your Kerberos authentication occur through Active Directory, and then have any policies that you want applied to your Macs still be applicable through OS X server. That's one of the things that I've been doing for 6 months, about 80% of my time. So it's kind of a big trend in more enterprise level networking. And you know, in a lot of those cases, you'll have 300-400 Macs in a 10,000 node environment. So you don't want to necessarily extend your Active Directory schema to accommodate for them, and cross-realming helps you keep from having to do that. Another great product, which I think I mentioned in a later slide but fits in here, is Centrify. Centrify will allow you to do those same things, but it will actually allow you to edit those from the GPO tools. And who's used Active Directory with the GPO tools? And okay, so. All right, so I guess I don't really need to cover too much about IPFW because Jay kind of went into a lot of that, but there's also another thing that you can run in conjunction with IPFW called dummynet, which rather than block traffic, allows you to throttle traffic. So for example, if you're running an Apple File Protocol server and you want to limit the traffic that AFP or NFS can take on that server, you can actually use dummynet to limit that to half a gigabit, you know, on a gigabit interface. Or if you're aggregating your links, maybe a gigabit on a 2 gig interface. So this actually expands your ability to do traffic control, which is kind of cool. And in an Open Directory environment, by the way, password server doesn't replicate across your topology. So what this can do is, by default, each Mac is going to look at your Open Directory primary controller. So what you can do, you can use dummynet to actually throttle the traffic for each node. So you can essentially force them to use replicas as opposed to your main servers. You know, that's kind of a cool feature that it would be nice if Apple actually built in to a GUI. So if there happens to be anyone from Apple in the audience. So I gave Centrify a full slide. It's a nice product. It's clean. It doesn't actually add any Active Directory schemas. It just kind of puts MCX files out in the open. So what's an MCX file? If you have needs, like let's say you want all of your Photoshop users to be limited to not have a certain menu or something of that nature, you can actually customize your rules or your policies in Open Directory as MCX files. So that's kind of a cool feature. It makes the policy settings extensible. When you customize those MCX files, then you can plug them straight into Open Directory and have them replicate throughout your Mac enterprise. Bastille will export its settings into MCX, so you can actually configure something in Bastille and then plug it directly into Open Directory and push it out like that. So very nice feature. How am I on time? Anyone? All right, so service control. I kind of mentioned the fact that cron is deprecated in OS X. It's pretty easy to actually fire it back up. You just run it once, reboot, and cron is good again. But Apple is planning on removing it completely at some point, and so they're trying to push everyone really heavily into moving over to using Launchd. Was everyone here in my previous speech, or no? Right on. So just to cover, there is a GUI tool for Launchd, and it's called Lingon, and you can deploy it across a lot of machines pretty quick using ARD. It's a package installer. Lingon just gives you a msconfig looking screen and allows you to configure services that way. And it allows you to configure whether or not it's running as the user or root or something of that nature. So Lingon makes it pretty easy to determine which applications are loading and why as well. So if you've got a machine that's running slow, it gives you more troubleshooting tools. So you can actually look at a service, look at the path that's firing up the service, look at why it's firing up the service essentially, and then disable it and push that out as a policy, or just push it out as a config file change. So unlike traditional BSD flavors, Apple highly discourages you to, did I say that right? Apple discourages you to actually customize your RC files. So if you edit your rc.local, then it can be replaced at any given point in time, like your next reboot possibly. So don't do that. And if you are a member of the OSX server list and you say edit your rc.local file, like I did a pretty good while back, then expect to get flamed, because they can be pretty. So then I just listed a few paths for other startup items. So if you've got other startup items and you want to disable them or look at what's starting up and why, then it's right there. All right, so reacting to security incidents is kind of interesting in the Apple community. In a lot of cases, they're not used to it, so they don't react to it. They'll just reformat the machine and move on or something of that nature. Securing systems is one thing. I don't even like this slide, sorry. Has anyone used Symantec iButton, by the way? That's a great little feature that they plugged into their new stuff. It doesn't run on Mac, it's more of a Windows thing, but it's a nice product. So when it comes to building your own tools, things like Cocoa development, X11 development, there are a lot of Cocoa guys that will actually help and guide you through building Cocoa installers or real basic installers if you want to go down that route for the Apple platform. And then if you build a tool based on a bunch of shell commands, you can easily port them into Cocoa. You can just create a button and apply them to a shell script. So it's not that difficult to build your own security tools if you want to deploy them for your users. In addition to Cocoa, there's also AppleScript, which is less GUI-oriented. And in addition to AppleScript, there's this thing called Automator, which is a great way to send people things like shell scripts that fire up and run rm space slash space dash rf or something. So anyways, that was lost on everybody, or was it just me? You can do it. Anyways, so the Apple community is becoming a lot more friendly to security, but I still get asked the question a lot of times, why do I need a password? And that's something great to know if you're doing, let's say, pen testing in the Apple community, which gets us into traditional security tools like Nessus and Metasploit, which are available for the Mac and pretty much fully compatible. In some cases, as someone from Apple pointed out to me at Black Hat, Nessus may misstate the version of a service that's running and misstate vulnerabilities that might not be existent because Apple may have updated the package but not updated the header file for the package. For example, OpenSSL. So in those cases, manually just updating your header files will fool Nessus and get you completely around that. Not all the tools that are available on Windows are available for the Mac, just like they're not available for Linux. As with other security audits, no single tool is a one-stop shop. And then the last thing I say here is that the business workflow is often very different. Like I said, people still ask, why do I need a security? Why is it that if I enter my password more than three times, it locks me out? They're very, in a lot of cases, ambivalent towards security. And this can, when you're architecting a solution or architecting a network, this can kind of get in the way, but for the most part, they're catching up. So the fact that they've had exploits and they've had bugs and like the new airport drivers, they're starting to kind of get the point. So that was my hour-long talk condensed down to 15 minutes. Questions? Thanks. Yeah. I think I was just going for making them a little different. The typical load balancer or the typical firewall that you might see in more of an enterprise environment, as was pointed out earlier, a lot of Mac environments still have like a dedicated DSL connection, and the network admins actually don't attach them to their corporate network. They're not running, in a lot of cases, any centralized username password authentication. In a lot of cases, it's just 100 standalone machines that happen to, by the way, tap directly into the Exchange server or the Lotus Notes server using the Mac client, and therefore, you know, offer some form of connectivity between the networks, albeit discrete in some cases. So I still see a lot of networks and a lot of network administrators that are just like, I don't want any Macs on my network, period. They get to go on that network, and we just do our thing. And it, I mean, for the most part, Samba, CIFS, it's the same protocols now, and it's becoming a different environment. And I think a lot of Windows admins just haven't picked up on that yet. So,
can I run my mouth for a second?
Show enough.
All right, a couple of things. The Open Directory password policies don't get applied if you're authenticating to Active Directory. It'd be the Active Directory policies, right?
If you're cross-realming, your Open Directory policies get applied to Mac clients.
Well, the preference is what? The managed.
In a golden triangle?
Yeah, depends on how you're doing it, but your authentication is still coming from the Windows side, so you're the policy.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just running my mouth upstaging.
No, that's true.
That's what I'm here for.
The Kerberos still comes from Windows, and then your policies come from your MCX files on the Mac side.
And ARD is only enabled on admin users in the rare instance of the very first admin user created in server if you enable it in the setup pane. All other users have to, on a per user basis, you have to set up the privileges, actually, unless you install them via like a custom package. Because it maintains a separate.
Is that just for 3 or for 2.1 as well?
2 did that actually as well. So like on server, the very first admin has it, and then everyone else, like if you create subsequent admins from there, they don't have any access. And then ARD3 now you can limit by what, if they're an admin or a non-admin, you can actually kind of limit what their privileges are. But yeah, you still have to enable them individually. So, I mean, well, you can test it.
We'll think with it later.
So. And password server does replicate. It's the first server it can find. So like it's like a ping test, basically. So it will contact the master and the replica. And if the replica talks to it quicker than the master does, then it'll off that way. But like, you know, so. Like you said, just upstaging and running my mouth.
No worries. No, if I said something wrong. I mean, I've definitely seen a lot of cases, and maybe it was fixed in 10.4.7 where SASL and where various components just don't.
Yeah, it's all about your topology.
It's all about the topology. And in almost every case that I've ever touched an Open Directory network, it was deployed wrong. And I mean, I've seen Open Directory networks with Kerberos that don't have network time servers, that don't have DNS servers, and those are core components of any network service. I mean, you can't install Active Directory without installing DNS for the most part. So, and that's the same, it should be the same in an Open Directory installation. If you click on the Start Open Directory button, it should say, you don't have DNS configured. Should I create a reverse IP address? And, you know, yeah, next week. any other questions? Woot. Oh. Deep freeze? Deep freeze. Right on. I'll play with it tonight. I haven't played with it yet. All right. Thanks, guys.